Okay, question time. Lakshmi, you had to call the chairs for the afternoon. We didn't announce the chairs for the afternoon.
We've got Dr. Shama Kedar. She's got a very bad throat, so she's going to just say namaste to you as a chairperson. Could you just say namaste? She doesn't want to say too much. So, Dr. Lakshmi is running around because she is the backbone of this conference. So I think now, Dr. Shama, and she wanted to have a good view, so she wanted to sit right in front.
Good idea.
Good idea. Any questions?
Please don't hesitate to ask questions. This is the lifetime opportunity where you can ask questions to the master, Professor Sir Arul Kumaran. So if you have any questions, you are most welcome.
Sir has explained it very nicely, all the cities. And so I think there is
no question. Has,
yes.
Nikhil Devi.
Yes.
Prof, could you clarify on how you will distinguish between a trace with increased variability vis-a-vis saltatory pattern?
Okay, very good question. The when you draw the bandwidth between the two traces, the bandwidth will be less than 25 even with increased variability, and it will not be oscillating vertically. Maybe, can you put my, I can take it back to that trace. So when we look at this one, Daddy, for example, this one doesn't have a smooth. If you take any centimeter and draw a line here and draw a line there, that exceeds 25 beats. That's the first thing. The second thing actually is the increased variability will have a smooth running. But this one is almost like a vertical drop and vertical up because there is no time to pick up. In some way, actually, people think the autonomic nervous system is disturbed. It is, doesn't know where to pitch it, sort of thing. Julian Parra had done some work of infusing catecholamine into monkeys and so on, trying to reproduce it, but never able to reproduce it. So we don't know the mechanism. Some people try to shake the monkey and produce sinusoidal or Yuji Murata, you know, from AFOG. He was working in the States and he was trying to do some work as well. But no one was able to reproduce how to produce a sinusoidal or a saltatory pattern. But if you see a saltatory pattern, draw two lines anywhere from this to 25 beats from that one. And if it exceeds that, and if it is going to be returning back to normal, then it will come to normal variability. But if it doesn't return for 25 minutes, then if you wait too long, the baby will get hypoxic. So that's what happened here. As you could see here, the variability is quite normal. I think what happened here was when they put a 9 centimeter for epidural, it must have compressed on the uterine vessel and the baby was not getting enough. If they would have done a continuous monitoring, it would have shown bradycardia. So they could have asked the doctor, please hold on and straighten the mother so that the pressure is not there. That's why in the earlier talk I said, if you are giving an epidural in the late first stage, second stage, please monitor the baby continuously. They didn't do that. So when they put her back after nearly 1 hour, 1.5 hours, this is the pattern. So that should have stuck to them. Something has gone wrong. Give her some more fluids. So if you see this pattern, you have to give her fluids, give her some oxygen, see whether you can reverse it. If you can't reverse it, then you have to take her up for a C-section. So in the NICE guidelines, they have said more than 25 minutes of saltatory pattern, then you need intervention.
Any other question? Yeah.
In case of non-reactive CEG, how much time we can buy for decision making or counseling of the patient and relatives?
Okay, so the non-reactive CTG, we are talking about two situations here. One is antenatal, one is intrapartum. So, sorry?
At term,
right? At term, yeah. So in the intrapartum it's much easier to do that, because if you see some contractions, if it is non-reactive but the CTG is steady with good variability and no decelerations, that means the baby is under no stress. So you can observe for 60 minutes, 90 minutes, you can wait for a longer time. In the antenatal period, by 60 to 90 minutes, it should wake up. And there's no stress there like the contractions. So there you should try to stimulate the baby in some way. A lot of people use bicycle bells, the Americans use a vital acoustic stimulator and so on. So you should ideally continue for 90 to 120 minutes. Because 90 minutes, 95% of the babies will wake up. And if they don't wake up for 120 minutes, there's a problem there. But good variability means the baby is not hypoxic. But why it is not accelerating is the question. So the variability, if you draw two lines to look at the bandwidth, and the bandwidth is always over 5 at the beginning, middle, and end, so that means the baby is not hypoxic. If the hypoxia means the variability will go down. So if it is normal variability, even at some point, then you can wait with some certainty.
Sir, if an antenatal case comes to us in OPD and says she doesn't pursue any fetal movements suddenly, and if we do NSD, and if we don't find any trace, how long, medically, how long we should continue that tracing so as to declare IUD?
So, You do a CTG and there's no trace?
Yes, at all.
Okay, so
we have to declare, we have to tell something to the patient because she has come to us with no, for sudden loss of fetal movements.
Okay, so for that you have to use an ultrasound to see whether the heartbeat is there or not, because the not getting a trace, more likely there's a problem there, but you have to, if you're going to positively say the baby is dead, you have to make an ultrasound and say the heart chambers are not moving.
20 minutes or tracing will be for how many minutes, I mean to say? Just to in the court of, doctor stand in the court of law. Just to prove that the patient has come with sudden loss of movements,
yeah.
I want to explain to the patient and the court of law. If the patient goes to previously booked patient,
yeah.
She comes to us with no fetal movements, suddenly, the complaint is sudden, maybe
yeah.
Abrupt show, cord, whatever yeah. Problem may be
yeah.
There. But we have to prove that in the court of law, because patient came to us with that complaint.
Okay.
So for how many minutes we should take the tracing?
Okay. I mean, it can be 20 minutes, it can be 30
minutes.
Minimum
20 minutes, or is there any...
20 minutes, and if you can't get a tracing, then she must automatically go to an ultrasound to show there is cardiac asystole, there is no heartbeat. And you have to tell, then you have to investigate. Subsequently, as to what happens
afterwards. But
afterwards,
many
yeah.
times court can ask a question: how you will prove there was no fetal heart? How many days?
Ultrasound, by ultrasound. You have to do it by ultrasound.
Any other question?
They are still discussing whether this question is finished or she wants to ask a part two of that question. Alright.
Excuse me, sir. So just one question. Intrapartum monitoring, after onset of deceleration, how much time we have for the decision? Like, or is there any time limit after which cerebral palsy, the chances of cerebral palsy are higher?
Okay.
So, my decelerations last... which are coming up to again for the baseline.
Okay. As I mentioned, the deceleration is just the mechanism which causes the hypoxia. So, I have shown you three patterns with decelerations. The one is actually a long-standing hypoxia, hardly any variability and shallow decelerations. So that one by 60 to 90 minutes, if you don't get anything, but if you have additional signs like meconium, absent fetal movements, you have to deliver. If it is a gradually developing hypoxia, then you have a lot of time. And you will wait till the heart rate goes up and up and there is absent variability. And once it is absent variability, you have to deliver within 60 minutes. And if it is prolonged deceleration, the one I mentioned, subacute hypoxia, 30 to 45 minutes you have to deliver. So it depends on the type of deceleration, whether it's, how would you categorize as a prolonged period of hypoxia, whether it's a gradually developing hypoxia or a subacute hypoxia. So the timing will depend on the type of deceleration you see on the clinical picture.
Any more questions?
We have time, so please. Yes, please.
Excuse me. If the patient is directly coming to with labor pains, and how would I differentiate if there is a antepartum asphyxia or an intrapartum asphyxia, just in case if I have delivered a baby and the baby shows signs of HIE or something. So is there any other investigation with, I mean, if I have missed out a baseline CTG for her, so can I save my skin, whether it was an intrapartum asphyxia or an antepartum asphyxia?
If you see the baby is born in poor condition, and if they do an MRI, the MRI will show whether it was due to an acute profound or a prolonged partial types of hypoxia. So if it is, when she comes into the hospital, if something has happened already, when you do a trace or when you listen to the baby, you should hear a bradycardia, that means it's acute profound, or if you get repeated deceleration, it is partial prolonged. So depending on what you found soon after admission, you can determine whether the injury has happened even before you intervene. So within 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, you diagnose there were lots of decelerations, and then you deliver in 30 minutes and it is bilateral cortical atrophy. That means the injury must have taken some time ago, because it will take 60 to 90 minutes before the injury takes place. But if it is due to thalamus hypothalamic injuries, that means when you admitted her, you heard a bradycardia, you intervene, and still the baby has cerebral palsy, then again it must have started earlier on. Now, by doing a cord blood gases with these babies, you should be able to say whether it was just a few minutes ago or a long time ago, because the pH will be drastically low if it has started a long time ago. And you have to do cord arterial and venous blood, because the base excess deficit should be more than 3 if it is acute profound, but if it is going on for a long time, it will be less than 3, the difference between the base excess in the artery and the vena. So there are a few ways of establishing. One is actually by MRI, by your first observation of the heart rate when she comes in labor, and the cord blood gases will tell you what happened.
You've got more 20 minutes, yes.
If the baby is cried soon after birth, Apgar is good, still the baby can have hypoxia?
Sorry, the Apgar is good?
After the baby has delivered,
yeah.
Baby is cried nicely, the Apgar is good.
Yeah.
Still the baby can have cerebral palsy?
It can.
What are the chances, sir?
It depends on what happened in labor or before labor, because the cerebral palsy need not necessarily be due to the terminal events. For example, if the baby has a severe bradycardia for more than 15, 20 minutes going low, but then it picks up at a later time, then the baby might have a good Apgar score but might be affected by cerebral palsy. So really the whole picture has to be analyzed before you can declare it was not an intrapartum event.
I think sir has nicely covered all the problems of queries, whatever we are having for CTG, and everything is nicely told by with the help of the charts. I think there should not be any queries left with our audience. Am I right?
There should not be any queries, only selfies left later on, I guess. So can we now give a big round of applause?
Big round of applause for sir.
Well, sir, thank you very much. And I would also thank the chairperson, especially Dr. Lakshmi, for bringing such an eminent personality over here. Thank you very much. Hope to see you again on time. And for the ones who are not going to be on time, you're going to miss all the important part of discussion in the morning. So we are going to be on time tomorrow as well. Thank you. Have a very good evening. Until we meet again. Thank you.